Fluke Airways' initial owner was a Hollywood film producer who'd realized that he could buy a couple of airplanes for what it was costing him to charter planes to take movie companies to location sites. He used some of his cash to buy three of those surplus DC-3s, and soon discovered that they spent more time sitting around expensively than they spent flying cheaply. When somebody commented that he had enough planes to start his own airline, he casually applied for some routes and got them. Bingo! Fluke became a scheduled airline overnight, qualifying for federal subsidies to fly mail to remote communities. Now, I was hired as a purser, also known as flight attendant. Far from serving meals and seeing to the luxurious comfort of passengers, pursers loaded baggage, took tickets, did load and balance calculations, carried infirm passengers, and stood by the wing with a fire extinguisher when the plane was warmed up in the morning. Just before I joined Fluke, pursers had been relieved of the task of gassing up the plane at intermediate stops. Passengers had complained long and vigorously about the heavy aroma of raw gasoline produced by inevitable spills in the purser's uniform, and their expressed fear of fire was inhibiting income to the company. The applicant for this coveted position had to qualify for a bond that protected the company in case he stole valuables from the passengers. He had to pass a physical showing that he could tolerate unpressurized air travel, and had to pass a color vision test to show that he could distinguish green lights from red lights. Red-green colorblind though I am, I was not too concerned about this last requirement because I'd taken so many color mosaic tests that I had them pretty well memorized. Unfortunately, they gave me what's called a yarn test instead. This involves giving the victim a cigar box full of little tufts of colored yarn, each attached to a numbered brass disc. Half a dozen larger tufts of yarn on bigger brass discs with their numbers covered are set out on the table. The victim is told to sort the little tufts into piles that are all the same color but different shades as the big tufts. I couldn't sort those things to save my life, but I made a helpful discovery. As I gloomily lifted a small tuft and moved it uncertainly over the row of big tufts, I saw the expression on the nurse's face change. She scowled disapprovingly as I moved the little tuft near a non-matching big one, and she glowed happily as I moved the little tuft near the proper big one. When I put the little one down in the right place, she clucked happily. Thereafter, I did not look at the yarn, but looked at the nice lady's face. She guided me unerringly and unknowingly to successful completion of the test. I was pleased at the outcome, but wondered if she helped colorblind pilots the same way. As an acceptable physical specimen with flawless vision, I was hired and issued a uniform from a supply of old-style uniforms the company kept on hand. I also immediately ordered my own new-style uniform. The reason for the change in design was clear. The wife of the movie producer was a theatrical costume designer who had really got her teeth into the original uniforms for the flight crews. As a mere purser, I had three stripes in my cuffs, a narrow-waisted, high-buttoning, double-breasted coat with a bi-swing back, and a couple of dozen brass buttons. The trousers featured bold stripes. Luckily, all my stripes were of dark green ribbon, rendering me not too conspicuous. The first officer and the captain not only had more stripes, theirs were silver and gold. They were afraid to be seen in public. After years of moaning, the design had been changed to a conservative dark blue model, patterned closely after the Japan Airlines uniforms, to the discomfort of some of the former military pilots who still hankered to bomb Tokyo. Others, indeed, had flown for Japan Airlines when that line was first established with American assistance, and they were delighted to save money by using their old uniforms. My training was interesting, if brief. I was to spend 3 days riding along on various flights so that other pursers could show me what to do. The work was fairly simple. Take tickets, lift suitcases and boxes on and off the plane, and help infirm passengers up and down the aisle. The DC-3 must have been the last airliner with a tailwheel instead of the now standard tricycle landing gear, so the cabin was not level when the ship was on the ground. Passengers had to climb a fairly steep hill to get to their seats from the rear door, and some needed help to do it. The only complicated part of the job was keeping track of how much weight we were carrying and where it was. The captain gave the purser a sheet at the beginning of the flight that showed how much weight could be loaded at each stop, considering the weight of fuel, how much was burned off between stops, and how much was added when we gassed up, which wasn't often. The purser had to know how many passengers were aboard and how much cargo weighed. Passengers were figured at 150 pounds each in the summer, and 165 in the winter to allow for overcoats and galoshes. With as many as 16 stops in a flight and passengers and cargo coming and going, the purser had to do a lot of quick arithmetic to keep the pilots informed about the load. With a lot of cargo and passengers aboard, it was sometimes necessary to struggle up the narrow aisle to put stuff in the forward cargo pit, so the weight wasn't all in the rear pit dragging down the tail. Each purser had his own little system for quick calculation. The pilots weren't silly enough to rely on my arithmetic, of course. They just used the information to confirm their own hunches or find surprises. Now, one instructing purser kindly passed on some key knowledge, instead of letting me learn from experience, as was the jolly custom. He showed me how to operate the door safely. This had nothing to do with the safety of passengers, only with the safety of the purser. The door was a hatch hinged at the bottom, so that when you turned the large handle and pushed out the top, it would drop down, almost touching the ground. The inside of the door was shaped into steps, so the open door formed a stairway to the airliner. Chains on either side made handrails. When the plane was loaded and ready to go, the purser would lean out, grab one of those chains, and pull the stairway up, closing the hatch. Learning where to get support with the other hand without mashing your fingers as the hatch closed was critically important. Nervous new pursers traditionally grabbed the chain at their first stop and pulled themselves out of the airplane onto the tarmac. Ground crews rather looked forward to this spectacle as a break from routine. I was spared that humiliation. I was bumped from one of the training flights along the route because my seat was sold to a paying customer. I spent the afternoon playing cards in the hot office with the station manager, and his gossip about the business, the company, and its personnel was far more valuable than another airplane ride. After 3 days, I was a full-fledged, highly trained professional member of Fluke's crack flight crews.